and set up the thing. So is that okay? Just for 1 second.
Go on then. Fuck off.
Fucking sorry. Sorry. Just give me a moment.
Okay, Overton Archive, you're here again. Hello. Do you think the refugees will bring Ebola to the West? Yeah, sure, absolutely. There's no reason why that'd be nonsensical to assume. And the reason it's just me and Babel is Babylonian Babel. The group thing, having loads of people in a hangout, it can quickly become quantity over quality.
A shit show.
Well, yeah, it can become such, just due to the fact that you have conflicting personalities with conflicting interests and people with different specializations and so on and so forth. And yeah, it just... I'd rather just keep things on the level and chill out with a few people, two at max. Oh, we're both being narcissists. Oh, nice.
Am I visible? Am I visible just
you
right
are visible.
Now?
Yeah.
All right, nice. Yeah.
The contrast. Oh, you look so Semitic compared to me. Holy shit.
I know. It's the white clothing is not helping me really, is it? Yeah. It's sort of off white.
You have like kind of red skin and white clothes. I'm the opposite. I mean, holy
yeah,
shit.
Yeah. You know, they called the people in the Levant, the Phoenicians, were known as red men by the Greeks. And indeed, King David was described as rosy. So I think that there is a tendency towards if people in the Levant, when they're not brown, they have a reddish tinge. And indeed, I actually have something of a red beard. I'm a bit of a Barbarossa when I grow it out.
Yeah,
really.
Yeah.
That's why I don't generally. So I have a reddish root under the brown. I know a bright ginger Lebanese fellow, Maronite Christian.
That's pretty interesting. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I'm not that interesting regarding my hair and so on. I mean, my hair goes really.
You say that. The lion of Europe.
My hair goes really blonde in the summer. When it's really sunny and so on, my hair goes nearly white. And it used to, especially when I was younger. But and in the winter, when it's really cold and damp, it goes like brown. And right now, it's kind of in between. It's kind of blondy sort of brown. But I have to get a fucking haircut soon. I look like a filthy hippie. I really do. I don't think so. I can't get it. Go on.
You can. That's a haircut. That's a haircut. You can defend Europe in.
Yeah, I mean, I can't get a fashy haircut because my skull type just doesn't. I don't look good with your hair. I have such Anglo features. It just doesn't look right. It looks weird. I've always kind of had longish hair. I don't know. I might just get it kind of surfer dude kind of short like I used to.
I thought you were going to say surf, just say surf haircut. And I was what would that entail?
A surf haircut. Like a medieval bowl cut.
Yeah, precisely. Well, I think it was it the page or was it the squire who had the bowl cut?
I don't know.
One of the two.
Yeah. Or go for the friar, get the top cut as well.
Indeed, yeah.
Oh, boy. Terrible idea. Terrible fucking idea I'm doing that. Yeah, I don't know. I do need to get a fucking haircut, though. I really look like a hippie. Yeah.
I think the audience has other opinions, but...
It's weird. It's weird as fuck. But yeah, I mean, we'll see. Go on.
No, you go ahead.
I was going to talk about something completely different. So no, you go on.
No, I was just going to say during the I think former half of the millennial hangouts, I was rocking sort of a full on, very curled Jufro, and it perfectly cultivated. And I'm thinking that's I kind of like that, because that's like I support that. I support afros, you know, getting back to your roots and stuff. You know, don't try to do a hairstyle that doesn't come naturally to your people. Every race has their own hairstyle they can sort of slide into naturally, and you know, just let it happen. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we're not talking about the identity politics of hairstyles.
Yeah, precisely. I watched a film on this called Bad Hair. I think was it by Chris Rock? No, it was about black hair in America. It was very interesting. Sorry, go ahead.
Was it really interesting? What,
found it rather interesting.
You have some really fucking niche interests, man. I mean, fuck it out.
Well, I think that I'm very interested in, you know, minority identity politics and sort of group dynamics and psychology. I think it's especially with these groups that have been in diaspora for a very long time, you have these weird sort of cultural, you know, phenomena that develop. And I don't know. I think it's just cool to look at. If just for the sake of it's neat, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I don't know if you would define yourself as being able to relate to that sort of thing at all.
Yes, I would actually to some degree. Interestingly enough, which is why which is sort of what interested, which inadvertently brought me onto some proto alt-right or some dissident right media at a very young age, incidentally, by just being interested in the differences between Middle Easterners and Europeans. You find some you know, I don't know.
Yeah, fair enough. I was gonna say, this is what I was gonna tangent on, which is it's nothing related to what we're talking about.
No, go.
I was just having a very nice conversation with Survive the Jive before. Which is why we had a half an hour or so before I could do this with you. And one of the things he was talking about there was paganism and Christianity. And I don't know how interested you are in that topic, but it's...
I am.
As we learn...
I'm interested in Europeans... I'm interested in indigenism, in European indigenism. I'm interested in the way Christianity has you know, interacted with Europeans, yes, but I'm also interested in Europeans. The further back I see a people try to go, the more admirable I think that is to some degree. For instance, when people try to go back all the way to the Proto-Indo-European peoples, I think that there's a really admirable quality to that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's interesting that you say that. You say it's admirable. It's quite an interesting term to use. Not that I disagree with you, but it's definitely interesting. The millennial hangouts showed regarding a certain individual whose last name rhymes with cunt, incidentally enough, paganism, it can be quite a divisive sort of a topic. In the future, I am going to do a project with, and I've mentioned this a few times, so I might as well lay it out. I'm doing a project on traditionalism, on perennialism, with Survivor the Jive, with Mark Citadel. Don't know if who's heard of Mark Citadel. He's quite well known in NRX.
I think I have, yeah.
In fact,
I'm pretty sure I have.
Yeah, and Paul Hotherus, listener, who helps me do the Evelyn readings, American guy, yeah. And interestingly enough, Mark Citadel is a Catholic. Mark Citadel is a traditionalist Catholic. Hotherus or Paul and Survive the Jive, Tom, they're both. I know Paul's a pagan, or yeah. he would kind of class himself as such, or being along that trajectory. I don't know where Tom stands. He's a specialist on European history and so on, and I think he would describe himself as a pagan, or he's extraordinarily knowledgeable about these things. He spent a decade learning about them, I suppose. I would describe myself as a perennialist, which is kind of, I can relate to the two. If you see, I see the truths in Christianity, I see the truths in paganism, etc.
Yeah.
And that's a definitely an interesting topic. And I want to look specifically at this divide between the Christians and pagans in the alt-right and what it means. And
it's very interesting. It's very. I just think it's a terribly interesting matter.
And it's. I think it's an important one, and it's an important bridge which needs to be crossed. Hello, Greater Normandy. I was going to call you by your real name, but I don't know how much you'd like that evening. And yes, Cavell, woo. Pretty much just fucking woo me up, fam. Regardless. But yeah, that divide between the Christians and pagans, I think, is definitely worth exploring at some point. There are criticisms to be made on both sides, I believe. And I can say that because I'm looking at the matter from outside the box. And in my opinion, you can make criticisms about Christianity, you can make criticisms about paganism. There are problems with both ends, with both styles. And I think the way forward is actually a synthesis between the two.
Yeah.
To a degree. To put it shortly, Christianity in Europe needs to reimagine a pagan core, a pagan spirit. And that's the only way Christianity in the West can survive, in West Europe at least, concerning Islam over the coming centuries. Because at the moment, the Anglican Church, the Catholic Church, they aren't doing much in the way of preserving themselves.
Well, I would agree with you there, but I just want to quickly interject upon the point you said about a synthesis of Christianity and paganism, or indigenous European religion being generated. But I hear something. Well, I would just like to put this out there. A lot of Jews today say that Christianity is already you hear a lot of the pagans on the alt-right say, oh, you know, Christianity, that's a Semitic religion. But the people, a lot of Jews will say Christianity has been unrecognizably infused with indigenous European faiths and ethno-religions to the extent that it is no longer recognizable as a Semitic religion. What are your thoughts on that? Or even a universalist Semitic religion?
I agree with you. This is the point Paul has been making on West Coast Reactionaries in his series he's doing, where he's kind of critiquing Christianity, or at least exposing what its flaws are. There's a book, The Germanization of Early Medieval Christianity, which Paul mentions actually, which goes into this and how the early Christianity and the pagans who adopted it did so in a very specific fashion. I believe it was called Arianism, which is now actually seen as a heretical cult to most Christians.
Yeah, I've heard that. Yes,
but Mark Citadel kind of counters this, and we spoke at length. Well, yesterday I think. I can't fucking remember. I should remember. I think it was yesterday. We spoke at length about this, and he mentioned basically what he thinks appealed to the pagans was the idea that you had a god walk the earth as a man in the form of Jesus, who then ascended, and the kind of Semitic or monotheistic dualism of Christianity was then more easily palatable to the pagans, who didn't have such a strong system, or who didn't have such a dualism, because dualism is a very monotheistic thing, which is found everywhere in the world, but wasn't so much evident in North European paganism.
And it was found in the indigenous West Asian religions prior to pagan and indigenous faiths prior to the onset of the expansion of Judaism, Christianity, Mohammedanism, etc.
Yes, exactly. But I mean, I'll avoid going into this too much, but it's an interesting topic, and Mark's point that you had a god walk the earth as a man who then ascended back to godhood, essentially, or who ascended to godhood. And you had this seamlessness between the earth and the heavens, and that's the part of what appealed to the pagans, and where you kind of saw the link kind of begin there. But I mean, this will all be spoken about at length later on. But hell yeah, it's definitely an interesting topic, because the trouble with most of the arguments pagans and Christians have in the alt-right oppositionally isn't so much their metaphysical oppositions to one another or their theological differences, but the pagans saying, oh, dead kike on a stick, fuck off, Jews. And the Christians saying, stop fucking playing pretend. Your institutions in West Europe died out 2,000 years ago. Stop LARPing, essentially. Which are both extraordinarily shallow and pathetic arguments on either side.
Yeah.
Paganism still exists despite the collapse of its fundamental exoteric structures. And Christianity, the doctrines of Christ, in my opinion, and in the opinion of other pagans, do have problems with their inner esoteric doctrine regarding Christ's teachings and so on and so forth. It's a very, very big topic. And it's a very volatile topic as well, due to its nature, due to the fact that you're dealing now with people's personal religious beliefs. Yeah. It's how people interpret reality and the system with which they support themselves and their identity and beyond. And to start trying to break this down is, it's dangerous, but I think it can be done in a way where there is an open and honest, clean dialogue. And thank fuck, I think I found the right people who aren't pricks, and we can do it. So we'll see what happens when it happens. But hopefully,
yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. Yeah. I mean, and this is a great little plug for the upcoming series as well for anyone who's listening.
Yeah. It's definitely something I look forward to doing. Just due to the lack of such a thing, I've seen the lack of such a clean, honest dialogue there, which I think needs to happen.
Because there hasn't been a space, I would say, to some degree. I mean, look, it was shoehorned into the Woes hangout in a rather improper fashion, I would say, and I think that a place like this sort of, you know, it provides sort of a place for this dialogue to be held.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just thinking about doing it. I'm just thinking about how these things would happen, and it's all good. It's all in the works. I heard the last Catholic is called... I won't touch any of that.
Yeah, Janusz Korwin-Mikke. Yeah, I know him. He's a Polish politician. He's famous for his sort of outrageous speeches. He's both a royalist or monarchist and supports minimal government, sort of a minarchist, which is actually somewhat similar to my positions in a few ways. But I think he's a rather interesting character. Not terribly influential, though, sadly.
Yeah, Poland, that's an interesting case. That's a very interesting case. I wonder what will happen to Poland in the coming decades, in the coming 5 years. Do you have any kind of predictions or guesses that you're going to make or you want to make?
Well, I think I hope that Poland is goaded, or not goaded, but I hope that the actions of the federal European entity with Merkel or whoever at the helm push Poland, make Poland feel more and more culturally ostracized on more and more matters such as migration, social issues, etc. Because what we can hope, the minute one country leaves the European Union, whether it's Britain or Poland or whatever, all the others will. And see, Poland wouldn't normally want to leave the European Union because they've got a large investment in it. Schengen and the work visas and the education visas and things like that are of tremendous help to them because they've got a rather large portion of their populace living in other parts of Europe, Western Europe mostly, working. And they wouldn't want to forfeit that. They wouldn't want to get rid of that. But at the same time, if they get increasingly ostracized on cultural matters, if they have more and more migration forced upon them, if they have more and more, if they have social and cultural things forced upon them, because they're largely very strident Catholics, I don't think that they'll stand for it. And I think that they will push to leave the European Union. And once they're out, more will go out. And I'm not pro EU. I don't think that the EU will ever be the pan-European, the positive pan-European thing. It's made to deracinate and de-ethnicize Europe. I don't think it's a helpful project.
Yeah, I can't really argue with anything you just said. I agree. The sooner the EU goes, the better. To be frank,
would you go ahead? Yeah, and Poland could be the catalyst.
Mm. Yeah, or East Europe, I'd say East Europe generally.
Yeah, due to these cultural matters and a stronger rootedness to the people that exist to this day.
Yeah, it is. It just makes you. And again, this is brought up in my conversation with Mark Citadel, that if Europe's going to be saved, culturally, spiritually, East Europe is going to be the catalyst there regarding Christendom or Christianity, which I think will serve as the vessel. It has to serve as a vessel. Yeah. Christianity has to be the opposing force to Islam because it still has most of its institutions intact, even if in a shallow way in some areas. But nevertheless, it's still there. People are still familiar with the rituals, with the churches, with, you know, having their weddings at a church, so on and so forth. These things are still ingrained in the culture and still very evident, and they have that Christian core is still there. If it doesn't kind of regain its balls, so to speak, I mean, holy shit, some of the things the Anglican Church have been saying, like, as of late, be accepting of homosexuals and of gay marriage, welcome refugees, and so on and so forth. Literally every post-Marxist cucked position you could hold, the Archbishop of Canterbury has said, yep, let's do it. Christ says so. And why do these people have to be the ones in charge? Why? But yeah, that's the state of the Anglican Church.
Yeah. Jeez, you know? I mean, that is grim. I've heard similar things from other people. The state of one of the comparisons I often hear invoked between what may happen in the future and what has happened in the past is when Jan Sobieski III, I think, was it, fought off us, the Ottomans, in the Battle of Vienna, at the gates of Vienna, and I think it was Poland was spearheading this Christian united European force against the Ottomans and their forces, alongside, I think it was a bunch of Western European powers. I think it was Saxony. I don't even remember, but yeah, it was an interesting.
There's a question here in the chat. Should we all become Catholic again and actually go to church? If you can do it, then hell yes. If you feel that would serve a function, that would give you something, and the church you go to isn't, well, cucked, hell yeah, you should do that. If you aren't so inclined, then, as I am, I'm not a fan. Oh, it's not that I'm not a fan of Christianity, but again, I'm a perennialist. I'm quite detached from the cultural incarnations of metaphysics, which is a very fucking pompous thing to say. But it's true, I have no attachment to Christianity. Inwardly, I don't feel it resonates. The pagan inspired sort of manifestations of the extreme transcendence of Catholicism and of Christianity and of monotheism appeal to me. So the Gothic cathedrals and the ceremony and so forth. All these things appeal to me on a visceral level, on a spiritual level. However, these aren't the elements which are currently exoterically focused upon. I would struggle very much to attach myself to an external institution in the present age, which is Catholic. There are exceptions to course, of course. It depends on the church. I mean, I've been to the cathedral in my city, in Exeter, and I've been to the churches. And, well, I was disappointed, which is why I didn't go again, which is why I'm not a Catholic. Although I respect Catholicism, and I do believe Christianity will have to serve as Europe's spiritual vehicle to overcome Islam, without a shadow of a doubt, in some form or another. It's going to have to be Christianity. And if I can support that and push that along, I will. Even if I do it kind of from the side, from the sideline, from a kind of not from the center of the struggle, if you see. Yeah, as Cygnus says, Christianity is one mask of many, the substance lies within, absolutely. And I'm very much interested in that substance. But most ordinary people, on a mass level, on a collective level, you need to have a strong exoteric structure for people to exist with them. And this is what the West has lost and but must regain in the next century, within the next century. What do you think of Moon Man? Moon Man is the best man.
But before you weigh in on Moon Man quickly, I just wanted to say you remarked something about Catholic churches being unsatisfactory in terms of societal attitudes and whatnot. I know that in New York City, I can confirm at least once I went to a church and they had some sort of moment of silence for I think it was Eric Garner. And this was in the wake of all the Black and several other Black Lives Matter figures, and they had that whole thing. And I also hear reports that other churches in America have done the same thing. I mean, so just to give you a sense of sort of culturally where things are. I mean, this is of course in New York City, but
yeah, well, similar things happen.
And I'm sorry for infiltrating a church, guys. I just wanted to stop by and see what was going on. Actually, yeah, it was a girlfriend trying to Christianize me. Yeah,
you should have been driven out with a whip. Honestly,
I know,
like the moneylender you are.
Yeah, I know, like the happy merchant. The thing about Christianization is I'm not against Christianization of Hebrews because I don't want to preserve Jew identity. I want to preserve Hebrew-ness. So effectively, I don't care what religion they are as long as they know that their race is from the Levant, you know, from the southern Levant, Israelites, whatever, that sort of stuff.
Okay, yeah.
That's anyway, right. Moon Man.
Yeah, Moon Man.
Black can't you see? Matter.
They're worth less than fecal matter. Anyway, let's move on from Moon Man because Moon Man speaks for himself, to be quite honest. There's not a lot I can add to Moon Man. The man of moons. Kill a nigger tonight.
Someone mentioned Mormonism. Someone mentioned that America
prior to that, Osman Percy asks, how can we do our part, though? That's something which should be different for each individual. If you feel a resonance with any religious system, know it. I think for most of us in the West, we're adrift spiritually. And the first step is to reconnect with something which is prior to us, prior to ourselves and our being. If we're to have any traction whatsoever or any firm reference point with which to base ourselves upon, and to base our identity upon in our future, of course. This will be different for each person. For some, it will be some form of paganism or some Christianity. For others, it will be some brand of esotericism or something more occult. Doesn't mean something satanic or chthonic, but something more priestly, something more, you know, something hermeticism, for example. Know these things. Look them up. The resources on the internet are there for the first time in history. You have the option to learn about things in a very easy, straightforward manner. It's just a matter of spending the time and the patience in order to read these things and to, as Richard Spencer says, discover who you are. And that when he repeats it so much, it does become a bit corny, but it's a really good saying because it does mean a lot. And that is what the West and America will have a different scenario there, but especially we in Europe, we have to rediscover that. We have to undo all this nihilism and liberalism and materialism. We have to punch through all that nonsense. We have to cast it aside and get to what's important, get to what's valuable, which is hidden beneath all this bullshit. And it is possible. It just requires conviction and honesty. But I think on a mass level for the society, it will have to be Christianity. It will have to be, I don't know, it's difficult to say Catholicism, because I actually think there will have to be at some point a schism in the Catholic Church. That will become very evident. Like, there has to be a lot of important priests and chaplains, for instance, who openly, vocally say, this is what's wrong with the Catholic Church. we disagree because of this. This is what we're going to do. And that new, almost like a new reformation, I suppose. And that does sound very dramatic, and it would be very dramatic if it were to happen. But I think that's what it would need to take, essentially. Like I said earlier, regardless, Eastern Europe would be a good model to follow regarding how they approach religion, how they approach their faith, because it's an integral part of their identity, and it's very rooted into their ethnicity, into their history, and so on and so forth. And we've lost that in the West. We need to regain it if we're to stand against Islam, because you can't kill an idea with bombs. To fight or to survive Islam, Europe will have to have something to counter it with on that level, on the spiritual level. And it has to come from within, and it has to be about attitude and approach and self-assertion on all levels, including spiritual. So let's have a look here. What else? Greater Normandy says in response to that question, I do my part by doing what I believe in. Absolutely. Who is the most important person in the alt-right? Oh, I don't know. It depends. Because the alt-right is... it depends on how broad you make the term. We did a podcast a few months ago, and we defined it quite broadly as being this kind of internet-based thing where everyone believes in inequality at some level, approaching things from a right-wing perspective, and disillusioned with the contemporary right in politics. That's a very broad camp. Richard Spencer narrows it down by focusing on what he's done, and he did coin the term. Credit you to him. And yet, neo-reaction could be said to be part of the alt-right, or the reactive sphere, the manosphere to a degree. Some would disagree. Again, some people would disagree with all this. Who is the most important person in the alt-right? If you're on like a practical level, Richard Spencer, because he coined the term and does a lot of activism and so on. Same with Greg Johnson. Again, it does depend on where you are. Where I am in the UK, the London Forum is a kind of a alt-righty sort of thing to a degree. It was the London New Right, or there are kind of parallels. And these organizations change with members in different groups. So Jonathan Bowden was associated with Richard Spencer, who coined the term alt-right. Does that mean Bowden was part of the alt-right? He was part of the New Right in London, perhaps to a degree, rest in peace. But does that then mean, by association, Alex Kurtajic is part of the alt-right?
I don't know.
Again, this is the problem with these sorts of e-salons, as Gypsy would say. We did a conversation a while ago.
Yeah.
And that is what it is. It's very difficult to define. Anyway, I think the question, who is the most important, it's not really an important or a useful question. I think we should all be making ourselves the most important. We should all be doing what we can as much as we can. We individually, on a personal level, should be creative and outward and expressive and participating in this thing, this force, this culmination, for as long as we're able, because we might not be able to forever. So that's, I think, where the focus should be. The focus should be on who are you and what can you do? What can you learn? What can you share? What can you take part in creating? Whether you're involved in the identitarian movement in France, or nationalism in the north of England, or something in the United States. Again, it is circumstantial, because we're all in different places in the world and we're all in different contexts. Yes, yeah, okay, I agree with you, Babel. Taylor for USA, Bowden for UK. Although, I don't know about Taylor. I wouldn't argue that. I'm not American. But Bowden for the UK, again, new for the new right. And Bowden has been extraordinarily important, not just for the alt-right, but for nationalism and for right-wing philosophy and thinking in the UK over the past decade or two. So yeah, it extends beyond that a little bit. But nevertheless, Nightmares is the most important person in the alt-right. Of course he is. you know, don't even question
no,
it.
No, Nightmares really is the he's sort of the lieutenant of the alt-right, I suppose.
He's our lieutenant. Oh, man. Sunbeam says, I wish we had more sculptures around. I want to see sculptures and statues everywhere. Then make them. That's what, if you, it's cliche to say, but be the change you want to see. I didn't see a quite a relaxed, casual analysis of Julius Evola on YouTube. So I did it. It's there. It's a very niche thing, but there you go. It's there. It's an attempt. You can't do much else. Same with my upcoming project with Mark Citadel, Paul, and Sorad the Jive, regarding traditionalism and explaining it, or upcoming discussions on paganism and Christianity. I didn't see these things, so I said, fuck it. I'll organize them, and I'll do them, and we'll see how it goes. If it's well-received, I'll put in as much... I'll do the best I can to make it a worthwhile thing, and that's all you can ask of yourself. The point is, we're at a very interesting point in history now, where we have all the tools available to us to do and create what we like. Really do. All you need is a bit of creativity and a YouTube channel, and something can be seen by literally thousands of people. And it can have an influence on those individuals. And one of those individuals might happen to be part of an organization, and they might bring it up, and others might know. And how information spreads in the modern era is fascinating. And we have absolutely no reason not to take advantage of that. Because what we're doing is metapolitical as well as political, and it's cultural, you know, it's all these things. And there's no reason why we shouldn't do these things and take advantage of them. Morality official says, who become the next Hitler here? Yeah. Fuck off, you Jerry Cuck. Fuck off. Take that elsewhere. You filthy, filthy Jerry bastard.
So what do you say? What do you say we get back into some conversation now that I'm back? Just
I'm sorry.
No. It's fine. I just like the flow of things. I didn't mean that in a sense of like cutting you off or anything.
Yeah,
No. I rather liked hearing your responses to the answers. I just think that the alt-right is a pro-Israel safe space as rock tomato. See, the thing about the Israel thing is the extent to which I view Israel as bad is to the extent I view Israel as internationalist and dabbling in internationalism and whatnot. There's a very good video on this made by what's his face? Made by Mr. Ryan Falk on his channel New Europe ANP. And the video is called New Europe, New Jew Land. And it's about Israel and repatriation and partition. I recommend you all go watch it. So anyway, Adam, what is on your mind?
Not a lot. You know, like a toy monkey with the symbols. That's what's happening right now.
Yeah, I mean, I actually rather like that symbol. Perhaps I kind of want to adopt it as my next profile picture on my Discuss account after I'm done with the current photo I have of who was it? Laurie Penny looking like Oddjob.
Oh yeah. Laurie Penny, that's an interesting one.
Yeah, it's because it's Woz's waifu, that's why.
Roger Helmer beat him too, I'm afraid. I don't know if you read that.
Yeah. One man's chorus says we need to start drinking. I can do that.
I have water. I don't have any alcohol. We ran out after December after I drank all the Baileys.
You don't have any fire water?
No, I'm sorry. I'm not sophisticated enough. I don't have the glass of whiskey I need. You know, with the ice cubes. I can't pull an Arini, unfortunately.
You don't have gin with... See, I saw something that was a rather nice product. It was chillable ice ice, or sorry, chillable stone cubes, or I think it was obsidian, I don't even know what they were, chillable stone cubes that you put, or pumice, perhaps, cubes that you, that one puts in their alcoholic beverage to cool it down, instead of using ice cubes.
Yeah.
I kind of like that.
Some of this shit in the comments section. Oh, man, little woos. Oh, yeah, again. When will manlets learn? Manlets never learn, okay? It's just the way it is. The way things are, it's the law of the land.
Here's a question. How much of the audience guesses I'm a manlet? I bet a lot of them do.
You don't look a manlet to me. You look kind of average height. I mean, I'm like 5'11", which is a little... Well, I'm still growing. I'm 19, so I don't give a shit. I'm taller than everyone else in my family. My family are midgets. It's quite interesting, actually. So, you know.
Mr. Wallace.
Hello.
You can hear me, right? You can hear me?
I can hear you, yep.
All right, perfect. Sorry, just got my fucking Yeti, my blue Yeti operational. Sorry about that.
You're not the only one. Fucking Mark Citadel has one of those as well. And obviously Woz does.
Yeah. It's the official microphone of the dissident, right, I would suggest.
I need to get one so I can stop using this headset.
Yeah, you should get a Yeti. Although the headset actually offers a nicer audio quality than the typical headset does.
It's only a Sennheiser, it's a Sennheiser PC8. It's like £30. So I'm not sure why it's so good. It is good. Woz says it's really good, and he recommends people buy it when they want to do chats with him. Which is weird, because to me it just sounds it's okay to me.
Yeah.
And I've heard some good audio quality. I went in Academy for Music and all that stuff was there, and it was all good. So, yeah, Sennheiser. It's not Jewish. Oh, it probably is, actually. Yeah, it's German.
Yeah. Sennheiser, zer.
Yeah, well, yeah, Eve says, yeah, Jerry Cup, GTFO. I'm sorry, okay. Some German stuff's okay. Let me have a look here. What do you guys, why you guys talk about low rent fuckfaces like Orini? Because it was mentioned in the chat, and it was just, you know, and we haven't even spoke about Orini really. I just said I should get some whiskey like him, and pretend to be smarter than I am. That's how you get big on YouTube, right?
Yeah, but you have to remember to clink the ice cubes in your glass.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Men of the
and
West.
Didn't he have videos? Doesn't he have videos of himself firing pistols or something like that? I found Millennial Woz through him, in a sense.
Woz found the reactor sphere for Orini. I mean,
yeah.
I've watched a few of Orini's things. Some of it's quite good, and he's clearly not a moron. But I do think he's a narcissist. I do think he's quite vain. And image conscious, and
so there's on. Something about his presentation. There's something slightly off, and in a very different way, I would say that there's something slightly off with Stefan Molyneux, but that's a whole different conversation.
Yeah. It's just the pretension of trying to put on that false kind of yeah, I'm very sophisticated. Yes. Yeah, it's that kind of. Let me. Expose my knowledge to you foolish plebs and show you the way. It's that kind of a it's fuck off, you know?
Yeah. No, precisely. I think that and there's something about the way that he talked, that where he talks in a sort of drawn out manner, like he you know, a lot of pregnant pauses and you know, emphasis upon each. He really wants you to hear his voice. I would say that certainly is the case. I mean, if you like his voice, that I suppose that's all the better for you. But I don't know. I suppose I have the opposite thing, where I just talk really fucking fast, so no one can even understand what I said by the end of the sentence. It's like the Ben Shapiro phenomenon.
Yeah, Ben Shapiro. Oh boy. Let me hear what's in the comments. Everyone's just bashing on Arena now. Fair enough. Molyneux. Yeah, Molyneux, he's getting increasingly better, I believe. And I do, he's an interesting guy because some of his stuff is really good, but some of it's just a bit, his kind of, his anarcho-capitalist bullshit permeates through some of it to too much degree and gets in the way of, common sense. You know, anarchapistan is not going to happen. It never has happened.
Yeah, it's the libertarian thing. It's the fucking libertarian thing. The principles, they sort of draw themselves into these ridiculous positions. I almost began to get sucked down into that vortex, but thankfully I never descended. Are there any libertarians in the chat? I believe in small government, but the problem is I do believe in statism in many ways, or what they would refer to as statism, sort of authoritarianism. I'm in many senses an authoritarian. I did the personality test thing, or whatever that is, the political test thing. And you know where it put me? It put me as an authoritarian leftist. But apparently, monarchists fall into that quadrant as well. It's not like I'm some sort of commie or anything.
Well,
I'm not a trot.
Obviously, it depends on how you define left and right. Most of these tests you find on the internet, they lean left, no matter what you do. And also, a lot of the questions are quite loaded and phrased in certain ways, which don't make them very... what's the word? Wake up, Adam. What the fuck? Impartial, that's the word. Yeah, they aren't... They're often very... like I say, loaded. Monarchy would be right wing, in my opinion, by virtue of the fact that monarchy is based upon divine kingship and divine right of kings.
Yeah, precisely. There were no questions pertinent to monarchy, but I am a monarchist. But sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm a monarchist too, based upon that principle. Because the fundamental premise of monarchy is that the king is born superior to others and is fit to rule where others are not, which is a fundamentally ultra-hierarchical right-wing kind of statement to make. I don't know how that'd be on the left, unless you have some sort of cucked constitutional monarchy as we have in Britain, where they just kind of sit back and just kind of, they don't fucking know, it's nothing to do with me, the government, so, you know.
Well, there are some, these political things consider, for instance, the funding, the top-down funding of things like media to be left-wing, that's why I was authoritarian left, because I said, like, yes, very important on things like should the government fund media programs, should the government take care of their people, should the government I just think it's a lot of things that are considered left-wing, as a matter of fact. Left-wing can be right-wing in a nationalist framework. And I think that's the good thing about, I mean, one of the ideologies that does this is third positionism, but there are many others that sort of do this synthesis of both, I guess, I mean, national socialism even. What do you think?
Well, I agree with you. However, there's some stuff in the comments I wanted to address. First off, not all kings got the right power for religion. Absolutely, that's very true. Is monarchy heroic? In principle, yes, it is. It's the divine right of heroes in regality. And the king is the mediator between heaven and earth and is oriented upwards in that system. It's spoken about in Chapter 2 of Revolt Against the Modern World, in the chapter Regality, and also in Polar Symbolism, The Lord of Peace and Justice, which is Chapter 3, which is on my channel. Did that, yes, I think, fuck. Was it? I uploaded it earlier today, I think, the chapter 3. Is that law an extension of the sovereign's ego? Not in principle, it can be. There are plenty of bad monarchs in history, but the principle of monarchy has always been good. Monarchs haven't always been good. But it's like any political system. There is no perfect political system.
Whereas democracy, I mean, democracy, the concept isn't good. I would say that most democracies haven't really either.
Yeah. Absolutely. Again, it's a straw man to assume that just because one supports monarchy, one supports bad kings. No, you don't. a bad king is a bad king who needs to be offed and replaced by a good king. And it's much easier to have to do that than fix a broken democracy, because democracy relies on completely different
mechanic. Yeah,
yeah, completely different mechanics. A monarch is trained from birth in ruling and kingship and in his role in the state and his importance. And if he can't rule the country properly, then the country suffers, and he'll probably get fucking assassinated. If you want to look at it that way. And the easiest way to fix a broken monarchy is remove the king. To fix a broken democracy, well, how does a democracy get broken? When the population don't know what they're voting for, when you have liars and traitors in parliament who have elected and only got to where they are through lying and manipulation, when the public have a laissez-faire culture where they're happier to sit back than actually lynch the people who deserve lynching, as we currently have it, etc. That's a very big topic, and I can't discuss it all here just because of time restraints and the fact that it's midnight and I'm tired. But you know, it's definitely an interesting topic, and it's worth discussing perhaps at another time. Here we are. Have I read Discipline and Punishment by Foucault? No, I haven't. I need to read more. This year, I'm definitely need to read more. I haven't read a lot last year. I think I read a lot because I don't read a lot of books. But I do read a lot of essays and articles and so on and so forth. So I don't remember exactly what I read, although I have read a lot of things. Websites, Gornahor is one of the best ones, gornahor.net. Do you think marrying plebs like Kate Middleton is a disaster for the royal family? Yes, it's a degeneration. The classes shouldn't mix. Adam, how did you develop a reading habit? Any tips? Most of the stuff I read, I'm just interested in. Okay, I'm back. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? I should be here anyway. Babel, can you hear me? Oh, fuck it. I'll continue talking. Can you hear me? Oh, fucking hell, man. Come on, respond. I can't hear you if you're talking, by the way. Okay, you can hear me. That's good. Okay, everyone in the comments, okay. Regarding a reading habit, most of the stuff I read I'm naturally into and naturally interested in, so it's a hobby, right? A good thing to do is have a book that you read before you go to bed. If you're, I mean, I'm downstairs, right?
Yeah.
When I go upstairs, I have, next to my bed, I have a book. At the moment, I'm going through René Guénon's Crisis of the Modern World, which is quite a short book. I'd recommend it. But you know, if I go to bed and I'm not exhausted, I read a few chapters or a chapter or even a few pages, and I just work my way through it like that. I've done more unconventional ways of reading things. For instance, I had a PDF of Evelist, but The Doctrine of Awakening, and the PDF was fucked up, and all the text was wrong, and so on. And I went, so I decided to take it upon myself to rewrite the entire book from scratch. And I did it three times because I lost the files. But yeah, I've read that book three times now, and it's about Buddhism, and I recommend that too. But I ended up fucking getting rid of it. I'm going to get a physical copy instead of trying to fix broken PDFs. But I'm quite familiar with that book now. But I think for reading, I'm not a very good student. I'm not an academic. I'm not very studious, or I'm not as studious as I could be, so I'd be a terrible person to ask. Just read what you can, what you're interested in, when it suits you. Just again, it depends on who you are and what you like, what you're doing, and what you want to learn about. Think about what you don't know about, if and what do you think is important and that you don't know about. If you want to be interested in a certain topic, and you know, just fucking do a web search for it, and just read an essay or read a short book. Don't just start, you know, I'm interested in history, I'll read Spengler's fucking Decline of the West, which is like 1,000-odd pages long. Nonsense. If you're interested in history and you don't really know anything about history or like empires and civilizations, something short to recommend would be The Fate of Empires by John Glubb, or The Idea of Empire by Alain de Benoist, which is, again, a short essay. You know, just start small and just take it in your stride. It's, would you have anything to add to that, Ed, regarding reading and so on? Or are you like me, you don't do as much reading as you should?
The thing about reading today is because of the manner in which the internet information is presented to us, specifically over the internet in these articles, often a long article is sort of the new short book in many ways. People intake information has changed just so incredibly quickly. I mean, I know it's often pointed out, but the staggering rapidity of it is note. I mean, the thing about it is, it means that it's all a blur of information that's sort of in the back of your head. You may not remember the author. You may remember the publication you read. You read the piece out. You may not even remember that, but you will remember the information contained within the article, and it's rather an annoyance because then you can't do things like cite as easily as one would normally be able to. But information that was formerly garnered from a book is now garnered from just sort of an agglomeration of articles drifted into the back of one's head, and you get the same or more or better quality information even, but you won't know where you procured it, and that can be a really big problem sometimes. You know what I mean? You know, just if you need to just remember where you got it, just practically speaking, I suppose.
Yeah. One of the best things, or one of the best ways I've been reading books recently, I'm doing this with, I did this with my King James Bible, I did it with Ride the Tiger, I did it with Revolgus the Modern World, and I'm also doing it with Crisis of the Modern World by Guénon, is leave notes and marks and annotations. Perhaps not on the paper if you don't like, but just like get like this is quite handy. Hold on, let me just give myself video again because I think that's the problem why my fucking Firefox keeps crashing. Here we are. So these, you like sticky notes, like sticky labels, and you used to put them on top of it and leave a note. You know, if there's like a specific paragraph which is quite like you could quote it. That's how, for me, that's an important thing. I look for quotes, things like sentences or paragraphs which are good summaries of ideas. I mean, if you understand or have kind of memorized the kind of context behind an idea, if you really want to go back to it, you can just leave a little reminder in there that this is the idea in full. This is what it means. And that's just one thing I've been doing, and that helps. I mean, I know PDFs and so on are a bastard to read. It's much better to have actual physical books.
PDFs are annoying to scroll through in that aspect. It is frustrating, you know?
Yeah, but I think it's just nicer to have the physical book before you. Either you can feel the pages and you can actually... It's just something... There's something nicer about it rather than just reading from a screen. Most of the reading I do is online, but for actual books, there's my copy of Revolting Someone World and The Hermetic Tradition and my Bible. You know, it's just nicer to have the thing you can just go through like that and leave bookmarks and I've highlighted passages in this, and you know, it's just a nice thing because it becomes more than just you're just absorbing information from a screen. You know, it becomes something you're invested in and you want to learn because you're interested and you're invested in the shows. Reading big books like this shit isn't for everyone, of course, but you know, Adam, have you read Nightmare's autobiography? Holy shit.
Yeah, it's a classic. That I keep it right on top of my mantle as a way of sort of signaling to people how sophisticated I am in my literary tastes.
Yeah, of course you would. Very, very sophisticated. Is that my whole book collection? No, I have more than three books. No, I have quite a few books. There's a bookcase in the other room, the bookshelf that's covered. It covers a wall. I have a pile of books I never bought. Bookshelf. Yeah, bookshelf. That looks nice. It's nice furniture. And you can show other people, look how smart I am. You know. Yeah, books are pretty good. I like to smell books, to be honest. Okay. Yeah. Well, you know, it's one of those things.
Yeah. Who doesn't like the whiff of
a good sniff of the old book? You know, totally not.
Jeez, that sounds like this thing. Precisely. That sounds now. To kiss the book meant to drink. You know. Oh, kiss the book. You know. It's like have a drink.
Oh, there's an important question here. One Man's Chorus asks: Never read Evola. Where should I start? Thank you, Imperial Aspirations. Start with Greynon. Well, I started with Evola, then I moved to Greynon. So this is get half books done. I left a comment on, I think it was part one of the Revolt analysis on my channel, where I answered this question. Evola's stuff can be very difficult to get into due to how wordy it is. However, Greynon is even drier. Again, almost an intellectual. He was an academic through and through, and it shows in his work and in his writing style. Evola can be very wordy and complicated, but often he uses metaphor and allegory and symbolism and constantly references other things and other sources. For this revolt analysis, myself and Paul are doing, we've had to learn the Greek just because he constantly looks back at historical circumstance and gives context to what he's describing, and it really helps you understand what he's talking about. Evola was an artist. He was a warrior poet. He was that archetype. But yeah, regarding, if you want to start with Evola, if you're interested in the big three, that's Royalty as the Modern World, Men Amid the Ruins, and then Ride the Tiger, which will play off one another chronologically. The framework which is discussed in Revolt Against the Modern World, you're best off reading Gainon's Crisis of the Modern World, which I'm currently going through again, before tackling that, because although Gainon is drier and more academic, and I don't know, he was a mathematician, right? It definitely lays out a lot of that stuff and gives a lot of context and even more background and more specific understanding to what Evola describes in a more artful form. Gainon's work, however, is very varied and it's all metaphysics. Evola was involved in politics to a degree, and it's more approachable because of that, and that's why Evola is more well known. But yeah, definitely read Crisis of the Modern World by Gainon before looking at Evola. That's how it was for most people. I made the mistake. The first book of Evola's I tried to read was Ride the Tiger, which is the stupidest thing to do because Ride the Tiger is the most impenetrable book I've ever read. Regarding the amount of things which Evola criticizes, quotes, references, you need a lot of foreknowledge in order to actually understand what the fuck he's talking about half the time, because it's all in relation to other things. He goes through all the options essentially of the modern world in relation to the differentiated man of the traditional world, and just kind of crosses them all out and says, nope, here's my philosophy of Riding the Tiger. But yeah, definitely I'd say do that. What do you actually think about Hermeticism? I read the Kybalion without any prior knowledge and didn't really get it. That's the point. You're not supposed to get it. Most people aren't supposed to get it. Hermeticism is interesting. It's the Western occult tradition. Read the Kybalion again. The Kybalion is a well-known book. This is nothing to do with you, Babylonian. I'm very sorry. I'm just asking questions here.
I was about to say, this sounds like the counterpart to, Eastern mysticisms.
Yeah. You have Western mysticism, which is Hermeticism is really the framework of that. Well, the thing is, Understanding Evola, when I read Ride the Tiger, I had read nothing prior. I just thought, oh, this is an interesting idea. The modern world sucks, and this guy tells you how to deal with it because you don't like going to parties. Which was my reaction. I was like, what, 16? And I'd read nothing, and that was a stupid thing to do. But since then, I can go back to it now and say, yeah, I understand. But again, it takes time. If you don't understand something, just take your time with it. You know, it's like anything. No one is going to be born a great intellectual. It takes time to understand things and to learn. It's all a process. Check out Manly P. Hall on YouTube, says Cygnus. Yeah, excellent. Yes, Manly P. Hall was interesting, although I disagree with the man on a few things, or at least in his conduct. Manly P. Hall is definitely a good primer for the esoteric and the occult. But you know, it's just one of those things. It's a worldview and a mindset which is so detached from modern living. We don't have the logical and mental intellectual tools with which to approach it, because we don't need to, because everything in our lives is materially based, is modern, postmodern, and you know, post-existentialist, so on and so forth. All these philosophical frameworks which have influenced the West, the modern West, we've been born up and brought up in, and that's how we learn. Okay, I'm going to stop using my video because I think that's the problem here. If I get another crash, then holy fucking shit. I think what I was saying there was, we've been brought up not with the correct tools with which to understand a lot of these things, which are important, which are integral, which exist for a reason. You know, it's a very basic, and this is a materialistic standpoint, but from an evolutionary perspective, and this is something most people understand, anything in the human society or culture or behavior which isn't vital or important or doesn't play a role doesn't survive. If religion had no purpose and no function and no use, it would have died out. But that's not the case, because man is more than just than flesh. It's just the way it is. So there we go. I'm going to stop ranting there, because holy shit. Actually, hold on. What is the occult? Evola did a good book on that, or essay. Look to there. yeah, Manly P. Hall strikes in the grave from a, yeah, from Cygnus. Anyway. Here we are. Did you have anything you want to talk about Babylonia? Because I'm doing an awful lot of rambling.
No. I was actually rather interested in hearing what you're saying, as I am not that familiar with Evola, because I actually deliberately didn't acquaint myself with him, because I thought for some reason it wouldn't be applicable to me because of his constant Indo-European references and I think framework, which I think perhaps isn't that relatable from my position. But I have dabbled a bit here and there. I was mostly, you had referenced Spengler earlier. That's something that I highly recommend reading to anyone who does want to embark on a long and laborious literary endeavor. Mm. And Adam, you wanted to say something about answer a question. So go ahead.
What is your opinion on Sinead / Firestarter Media / Chicks a Goddess? I personally think that she is bad for white nationalists, said Thylacine. Yeah, I agree. I'm not a white nationalist. However, white doesn't mean anything to me. I'm a European.
I'd like to get in on that in a moment.
I'll finish my point. Those sorts of people, as we saw from the WoW streams, they're not worth considering. Ignore them. They are harmful agitators, malevolent, rude, boisterous, bullying, simple-minded, stupid, uneducated, foul-mouthed, and rather nasty. I don't think highly of them. So yeah, that's my...
All right, brilliant.
Yep, I'm done.
I wanted to just say something about the phenomenon of white nationalism. Lowercase white nationalism, sort of lowercase WN white nationalism, I think, may be, or pan-Europeanism or whatever you're going to call it, I think may be necessary, whether it's under the banner of Christendom or something else to some degree in the future. Reactionary Expat, I think, did a rather good video on this matter called Stuck Between a Rock and a Hard Place on white nationalism. But looking at the phenomenon of whites, and this is probably, I shouldn't be doing this, being a Jew talking about white identity. I'm trying to be some sort of entryist subversionist here. But anyway, here I go. The concept of white, I was talking to you, Adam, about this earlier. I think it was one or two days ago, and I was saying that white is a purely, or not purely, that's too much, but white is a largely, first of all, it's a purely New World construct, or at least a colonial and largely New World construct. And in addition to that, it was a primarily pragmatic and sort of utilitarian tool, the identifier of white, because oftentimes it just meant that the person could fulfill a certain sort of intellectual and cultural obligation and therefore could assimilate in some ways and fulfill certain tasks, etc., etc., etc. And for instance, if you look at the caste system in many parts of Latinized America, and if you look at the slave system in North America, it was never a matter of white as being an identity. It was a matter of white being a practical and primarily utilitarian categorization for I don't know, legal matters or political matters, or to some degree broad cultural matters, but in the sense of you know what I mean, right? I suppose that's my view on the idea of whiteness and white nationalism. I think that it's a New World thing that doesn't necessarily resonate that much in the Old World. I mean, because even now in North America, white, what is white? White is white's been expanded to mean North Africa, Middle East, and the entirety of Europe, the Caucasus, and yeah, so technically I'm white in America, and I'm white in the sense that, you know, a Dindu attacking me would view me as white, but obviously I don't culturally fit anywhere within the framework of Europe. So it's very interesting the way that things like this work out, and because of that I ultimately think that something like white nationalism is you can't base anything off of it. It's going to be a practical tool. It's rather like the white identity was in the first place, and like Reactionary Expat says in his brilliant video, is a disquisition on this from about a month ago. Hello. Oh my God! I think he's dead. I think Adam's dead. All right. Can you hear me? Someone in the chat say if Adam's talking, because I can't hear shit. Is Adam dead? All right. Well, anyway. Okay. So. Adam just left for a second. Okay. So, I suppose I am going to do some entertaining here. All right, I am not very good at this. So, anyway, what am I going to talk about? White being utilitarian, New World identity utilitarian. See, this is the thing about when you enter a new continent, you're sort of starting from something of a blank, well, not a blank slate, because there were several ways of indigenous peoples, but I think that because of just the nature of things, they try to establish a new social system. They try to make categories like this. When you try to fuse all these different elements together, as they do, especially in America, with the different European ethnicities, and as they did to a smaller degree in many of the Southern Cone countries, I think, in importing various ethnic groups from Europe. I don't speak Yiddish. That's an Ashkenazi language. I'm not an Ashkenazi Jew.
I'm not going to sing in Arabic for you either. I could, but does anyone in the chat have any questions? But the thing about white again is it would be nice if the Americans had preserved to some degree their European ethnicities, because from Baghdad and in the UK as well. But I look kind of white. But see, the thing is, I was reading a study on this earlier today. It was a study that was talking, it was purely genetic, and it was discussing the effects of Arabization, the genetic effects of Arabization in the Levant region of West Asia. And what it concluded was that during and upon the onset of Arabian invasion, the indigenous peoples, that being, you know, Canaanites and their derivatives, Jews, Phoenicians, modern-day Lebanese, other groups like, of course, Samaritans, Canaanite derivative. Fucking hell. Hello, Adam. Sorry. Give me one second while I deal with this Dinduism going on outside.
Fucking hell, man.
No, okay, sorry. But the point is, basically, Arabization had a large genetic effect upon the Levant, and the original people there resembled much closely peripheral Southern Europeans today than, for instance, Cypriots, Sicilians, Cretans, etc., than the populations residing there today, like Palestinians is a good example, or even modern day Iraqis, or I would say to some degree genetically different from the original populations that lived there. So if you're wondering why I'm quote unquote white looking, this is what the indigenous Levantine look resembled, and you can look it up yourself. Look up Jews from Iraq and Persia and Lebanon and all those good places, Syria, etc. And they generally they range, but they can get rather whitish. Yeah. Non-white Europeans, I suppose. Anyway, good to have you back, Adam. I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, it's fine. I just went, you know, got into my pajamas and, you know, got a new glass of water.
Always very nice, very nice. I'm glad I'm not the only one on the alt-right who wears pajamas.
I don't really. I only wear them when I'm about to sleep. I sleep naked.
Glad I'm not the only pajama boy.
Yeah, I just getting comfy, get my slippers on, you know.
Always nice, yeah. I just got a pair out this week earlier.
Nice. I got some
gel soles.
Yeah, I got some stuff for Christmas, which is nice.
That's lovely.
Yes. I just got a new glass of water as well because my voice is getting a bit faded. All this talking, but
go for it. In the meantime, I'm just going to quickly answer the question of Midcal 9. What are the main differences between Jews? Some are secular, some are religious, some are nationalist, some are cucks. Most are cucks, actually. Some are anti-Western and have a grudge, and some don't. And that's all I'll say, I suppose.
Well, fair enough. Oh, man. How long have you been doing this nonsense?
Rather long, I suppose. I think this was a rather productive chat, if you ask me.
I believe so as well. Very, very good stuff.
I've gotten all hyped up talking to you and drinking this yerba mate.
I'd say just for people in the chat, if you have more questions, that'd be good. It's always good to respond to questions, I think, because I don't do it enough. And people seem to believe I have a vantage point, and maybe I do. But it kind of... it ticks boxes, you know. If people have questions which are unanswered, it's always good to give it a go.
Am I a Shoah denying Nazi, says morality official. Oh my god, I can't even touch that stuff. I'm not even going to do that right now. I'll probably talk about that on my own channel at some point.
Yeah, but my view of the Holocaust, I don't know, it's a very complicated and sensitive area of history, of course, as we all know.
All I'll say is that it's been made into something within the sort of anti-European mythos and framework. It's been made something of an original sin. It's been put in the place of things like the Atlantic slave trade and imperialism as these original sins of the European man.
Yeah, absolutely.
And therefore it must to some degree be deconstructed inevitably, I think.
Yeah. I would say regarding the Holocaust and so on, I think it's been exaggerated. I don't think it didn't happen. I don't think it's a hoax. But I do think things have been exaggerated. Pull that context. Things have been manipulated and taken advantage of historically. But it's not good. As Willinger points out implies in Generation Identity, I think I said this earlier, we're now seeing a generation which is detached from the guilt that conflict resulted in. We're seeing now a generation who aren't concerned with being called Nazis and racists and so on and so forth.
Because it seems like something that has been mythologized and something that's in the past.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
Precisely.
We're rather detached now from that conflict. We know it happened, but we won't. I can say things like that and not feel guilty because my granddads were both, seriously affected in the last war, and there are obviously these things have consequences, and they have a massive emotional, mental, cultural baggage. So, for example, I was talking to my grandmother about the last war and the Holocaust and so on. And I said, "Do you really think 6 million Jews were killed?" And my nan is middle class, so we can have these conversations. And she said, "Yes." And the conversation went like, my nan believes that, and she's in her late 60s, that all of what happened in the last European Civil War was down to Hitler. Hitler personally orchestrated the Holocaust. He started it. He is responsible for the French women and children who were killed, and so on and so forth. All the bad stuff. And that's how these things have been mythologized into the cultural kind of consensus. But we're now seeing a generation who are kind of divorced from that, which is a good thing, because irrespective of whether or not these things happened in such a manner, it's not irrelevant or unimportant. It is important. These questions are important. They are not of zero significance. But there has been a resulting, as we all know, guilt complex which has been generated, which is extraordinarily harmful to Europe in the long run. And now I think we can see generations which can pursue those positive things without all that inherited guilt,
without the dark cloud of those phenomenons. And Ika Musume, I listened to Benjamin Netanyahu, and actually I've been somewhat swayed to his point of view. I to some degree agree. Anyway, sorry, Adam, finish your point.
Yeah, I was just going to say it's a good thing now when we're seeing a divorcing from that. Sunbeam asks me, what's my opinion of Hitler himself? I share Evola's view. He was an effective leader, and there were good parts to him, but overall he was a dangerous, possessed sort of man. I much prefer fascism to national socialism. There's nothing which I'm not drawn to Nazism in the same way. I'm interested, and I look at fascism and I think it can be... Well, you had British fascism, you didn't have British Nazism, did you? Hitler himself, I think, had an ego, or he had a chip on his shoulder, and this was obvious in various points in his life. Just the sort of strangeness of the man. Maybe a lot of this is propaganda. Obviously, the biggest problem with the last war and trying to form a clear opinion of it is the amount of propaganda, and obviously all these things determine what information is available in what manner. Hitler is a man I I don't really have any strong opinions or convictions of regarding, because, well, overall, it's just not an important topic. But nevertheless, I'm not really a fan of National Socialism, although, like anyone else of any reason, I can look at the good and bad things of National Socialism without thinking, oh, they killed the 6 million Jews, evil, 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 you know?
Yeah, I believe it was Bowden who used the metaphor of the dark cloud or fog hanging over the European people, and that dark cloud is the it is World War II, it is colonialism, imperialism, it is the murder of all these non-European groups, it is the slave trade, etc. And do you know the quote I'm referring to? What do you think of it as that idea? I think that these clouds are now beginning to disperse in a sense.
I totally agree. That's what I was going to say. That's a very good analogy and a good metaphor. Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. I agree. I agree totally. Now we're mentioning the Jews in the comments, I see. Oh, boy.
I can handle any Jew-related things if anyone really...
I wasn't worried about that. I know you're fine with that.
No, that's not what I mean.
You're not going to start crying about anti-Semitism, are you?
Oh, no, it's not. It's not even that. Yeah, imagine if one day I just turned and it's just like suddenly I got really offended. Like, that would be fucking hilarious. I just snapped out of it and I was like, oh my God. No, but no, that's not going to happen. But what I meant in terms of I can handle it is I can take any of the question, like if anyone has a question that is pertinent to the Hebrew race, I would be more than willing to shed my perspective upon it if it is needed.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know, the JQ, it's often overhyped, and the importance of these sorts of things is often overdone because it's not as conspiratorial as someone would imagine. I don't really think it's... There is a general consensus among a few people that everything we're seeing, all the deterioration and degeneration, all the bad things we're seeing are the fault of conspiring Jews who want to destroy the white man. And that's so, so childish to think such a thing. It's so simplistic. Other forces are at work. Again, I've said this elsewhere, and it's again, it deserves its own particular video or piece of writing or discussion, just to try and look at this and swim around it and attack it from different angles and so on. But yeah, it's a very, very... The world is a complex, crazy place. It isn't just one group at the top of things. The JQ, however, is a real thing. There is genuine reason to be interested in the topic. There's a genuine reason why the topic exists as an object of curiosity. It's not just as simple as it's all dead Jews, you know. Again, it's nuanced. Reality is very nuanced.
Nuance is really the key word to just enshrine when discussing matters like this, because I think that it's precisely what you said. People fall into one. People are sort of, and to some degree, this is the fault of the left, the cultural Marxists, the Jews, even to some degree, at least in the West, for creating this framework, which places everyone who isn't, you know, believing in the all those established figures as a genocidal maniac, a genocidal white racist, white supremacist maniac, a white supremacist. See, that's a term that's very interesting. I don't want to get into this too much here, but it's very interesting. I've met very few, very, very, a handful of people who identify as a white supremacist, but that's often what's levied by the left against anyone who shows any sort of crime thought, I suppose. I don't know. It's own topic, I suppose. But some people in the chat want us to discuss Middle East. But Adam, get in last words before.
I want to look at the topic.
Or if you want to wrap up? Sorry, go ahead.
There's a few things here. A few questions I want to look at. What's the best country in the Middle East? I don't know. Syria before all this nonsense. Libya before they were fucked up. I don't know. Well, Libya is technically in Africa, I suppose, but it's Middle East and it's Islamic in temperament. Let me have a look here. What's our view on Palestine and Israel? Doesn't mean anything to me. It's their fight. They've been doing it for thousands of years. Let them get on with it.
It's not really a European conflict, as I suppose how I view it.
Someone says, go to TRS and tell that to them. People take TRS far too seriously. Most of what's on TRS is found on poll, and the trouble with
called the show, basically. Yeah.
You know. The trouble with that is that a lot of the kind of irony which surrounds poll and is it, and you understand it, the nuances of the culture while you're there, isn't really carried over in the same way, and there does become a muddling of reality and jokey elaboration and the kind of nuance which surrounds in jokes and irony and so on. TRS, I like those guys, but you know, at the same time, I'm not. There aren't many parallels between the two of us.
As the TRS crew, I believe it was Seventh Son, said in a song he once made, "None of This Matters." He once said, "The alt-right believes their own memes," and I would say that that is indeed a large part of what goes on with the TRS fan base, especially as of late. A large portion of them seem to be growing to believe their own memes. In a sense, you can't do that, you know.
Exactly. And it's because a lot of these jokes have been taken out of their original context and thrust into an area where they weren't born. Where a lot of these
forum sometimes even.
Absolutely. And they don't belong there. All these sorts of things. It's good to have these sorts of jokes because they are reflective of a community and all that's good stuff. But like you say, a lot of the nuance which engulfs something like Paul on 8chan or 4chan, a lot of the nuance there in the culture, the unspoken rules which surround these sorts of places, isn't carried over, and once you strip away all that nuance and unspoken complexity about these matters, like you say, jokes can suddenly become not jokes and vice versa, to put it simply.
Have I talked to Muslims in person? I've talked to an immense amount of Muslims in person, but you can go on that first, Adam. I've had immense experience with Muslims for generations.
When I was growing up, I had best friends who were Muslims. They were Muslims. They're my enemies because they're Muslim, but and they exist within that structure within Islam, and that's the way they are. That's their tradition, and I respect that. What's my opinion on what them as people or their system or the sorts of people the system pumps out? As people, most of them seem quite honest and quite decent people, the ones I knew at least. If not, they were not Western and they knew they weren't Western. That's part of them as persons. They knew they weren't Western or English. Their system, I spoke about that earlier. I respect Islam. To a degree, I like Islam. It has many problems, of course. In the Islamic world, the Islamic people, Arabs, have a huge number of issues.
If you're saying Arabs are the Islamic people, I would certainly say yes. But don't you predominantly get Central and South Asians over?
Absolutely, yeah.
Islam is a sort of subway Arab nationalism on top of that. So you're actually right in your train of thinking. So I didn't mean to.
I wouldn't say, it's not, obviously not just Arabs. I'd say Middle Easterners, they have a lot of cultural problems which exist beneath Islam. Islam.
Oh my God! Reported for hate speech. This is the point I break. I get offended. And I leave. All right.
Well, for instance, Rotherham wasn't the fault of Islam. Islam did not cause Rotherham. However, certain attitudes which are prevalent in the Islamic community facilitated what happened. There was nothing in the Quran which said that all this is specifically right and just. In fact, you could say the opposite. I'm quite sure a Muslim or a Sufist like René Guénon would say that was absolutely abhorrent, disgusting, and they should all face death penalty, even though he was a Muslim and knew Islam extraordinarily well. But at the same time, they're Muslims, and that's just cause for them not to be in Europe, because this is not Islamic territory. and it's pagan Christian territory. It's European territory. Our ancestors fought and died for this land and made it what it is. And we cannot give it away. We should not give it away, and anyone who wants to give it away is a traitor. Let's have a look at what's that, what else is here. Muhammad was a pedo, TBH. Fucking everyone was at that point in time, I'm afraid.
That is actually, especially in that particular region,
That's an argument that someone from Pegida would make. And it's a non-argument. It's a silly little point. It's like the whole trying to frame all Muslims as violent barbarian pillagers. They aren't. Those people that exist within that nation.
Hello, testing. I assume that Adam's connection has just cut out, in which case I shall answer the questions about
We are. I'm back.
Sorry, go ahead with your idea. I have something to say afterwards, but go.
Yeah, I was just going to say, yeah, that's a non-argument that someone from Pegida would make, that all their pedophiles, it doesn't mean anything. There are pedophiles in all cultures. That doesn't excuse what happened, and so on. I'm not saying that, but if you're going to criticize Islam, you need to criticize the doctrine of Muhammad. You need to criticize the Quran. You need to go right to the metaphysics of the religion and make your criticisms there instead of just saying, oh, these cunts are acting like cunts.
Do you mind if I do that, actually, for a brief moment? Because someone wanted to ask me my thoughts on Muslims.
Go ahead, do what you like, yeah.
Sorry. I just wanted to, I suppose in a way, I admire Muslims, especially Arab Muslims, because I look at them and I see, to some degree, us. If we had had land, they had vast amounts of land. Things like they developed, like architecture. I don't really. I mean, all right. Anyway, I admire the masculinity of the culture, and I admire the dynamic nature of it. But I think that there is an incredibly insidious nature. I think that there is an incredibly insidious nature to Islam in this one particular sense, and that is it's in several senses, but this I consider to be the most, and that is the claiming of indigenous land in a religious sense and in an ethnic sense as being eternally from then on part of the Islamic land. They will go about to unwrite the history of the indigenous ethno-religion or religion. They will do their hardest to implement a Mohammedan past. For instance, you can even see it in the manner that they will always convert the largest and most prominent temple or church into a great mosque, and then incorporate that mosque, go sort of back incorporate it into their own texts. It's really rather fascinating. I think that or not their own texts, but their own sort of mythos, or they'll emphasize it, emphasize previous mentions of that place. I mean, you can see it with you can see it in the subcontinent when they do the same to Hindu temples, and the Hindus will try to reclaim them, and people will say, oh no, look at these evil Hindus and the innocent Muslims, you know. And it's rather the same thing in Israel, because in Israel they've got both from an Arab sense and a Mohammedan framework, they have done an insidiously good job of erasing any sort of Hebrew indigenous ties to the land, even to the degree that many in the West agree with them from that framework, I suppose. So I guess that's my thoughts on Islam. That's my thoughts on Mohammedanism.
Yeah. Someone says here, Lysander says, Islam is more than a religion. It's more of a political ideology that seeks complete control of the world. No, it's the other way around. It is a religion first and foremost, and it's political secondarily. In that you have the House of Islam and then you have the House of War. That's their religious doctrine which they teach.
I know precisely what you're referring to.
You have peace or you have war, and it's quite simple. But there's an extreme metaphysical dualism in Islam, a really extreme dualism, more extreme and more hard-edged than Christian or even Judaic dualism, in so much as.
In practicality, especially.
It's nonsense, because in Islam, Allah can do anything. In Christianity, it was decided very early on that God cannot do anything irrational. So God would not be able to make, the Christian God would not be able to create a rock so big he couldn't lift it, because that's irrational. In Islam, there are absolutely no restraints on Allah's will. He can do absolutely anything, and his will is completely eternal. And the point is that you submit to him. You submit to Allah, under his love, of course. It's all about submission. It's all about dominance. And this interplay of these two extremes, of extreme submission and slavery to Allah, and extreme dominance upon the infidel and upon your inner self. That's what jihad is. You struggle against your inner doubt, and you externalize that against your enemies. It's ascetic, essentially, that view of conquering in a struggle by conquering your enemies. Islam is a fundamentally warlike religion. It is a warrior's religion. It's a fighting man's religion.
Inherently expansionist, indeed.
It is inherently imperialistic.
It's a conqueror's religion. It's a winner's religion. Yes. And I think many are sensing that increasingly today. Some young men in Europe can even see that.
Turning
their eyes eastward.
Yeah, and that's one of the most. That's what makes Islam dangerous, is that it is so confident and so sure of itself, and so furious and raging and blisteringly destructive to all which is infidel, all that which is haram. And it's what makes the West in not a good position right now, because how the fuck is McDonald's and consumerism and television and
that fills no void. That gives you nothing.
Yeah. What the fuck is X Factor gonna do to that? Gonna say to that style, to that ideology? What is the kind of metropolitan nihilistic consumerism which permeates most of our civilization in the cities, for instance? What is the answer there to Islam? And Islam as a force is coming. It may be within in our nations right now, and rather disjointed and fragmented states in ghettos, and exists on the fringes of loons in ISIS who are really a puppet organization, and so on and so forth.
It can coalesce surprisingly fast. Yeah. That's what you'll notice, historically speaking, as well.
And Islam, but the thing is with Islam, there is nothing in the way of Islam beyond itself, beyond Islam, the Middle East's own inner petty nonsense and struggles. If these things were resolved, for instance, I don't think the West would ever stand a chance if the Middle East got organized. That won't happen, however, because the Middle East is not a simple place at all. But like I said earlier, Christianity needs to be the bulwark with which we defend Europe. And it needs to reimagine that pagan element, that Volkish core, which is the earth element, which is the
roots.
Like a tree. Like a tree. The roots are rooted in the ground, and the tree goes upwards, and it grows into the air and spreads outwards into the firmament. This is the sort of view, attitude, metaphysics we need to in Europe reimagine, recapture. We had it historically, and we can have it again. And it's imperative that we must. For the survival of our civilizations and ourselves.
Do you mind if I just quickly, before it's completely passed by in the chat, someone earlier had mentioned something about IQ loss in Arab countries. This is someone said it was due to inbreeding or cousin marriage practices, which are common in West Asia and West Asian cultures, Semitic cultures, but non-Semitic West Asians indeed. But what I think is the main cause of this is, see, education can only go so far. When all the successful individuals in the Islamic countries, predominantly the minorities, mostly minorities and a subset of elites within the existing countries, basically the high IQ people, were purged from the society successively, decade after decade after decade. You can see it going on throughout history. See, the minute you don't have imperial rule in this Islamic country, whether it's a caliphate, khilafa, whether it's a whether it's the Ottoman emperor, the systems that are imposed by them, the state system that they had, and the millet system for minorities, or the British, indeed, afterwards. The minute that they pull out, you'll notice that the Arabs tend to drive out and genocide and butcher the often indigenous ethnic minorities, and you know, plunder the goods of the sort of high IQ elites. And once those people leave the country is doomed. Education can only go so far after the high IQ people have really left the society. I think a lot of people place too much stock in education in regards to saving these Arab countries. I really think that demographically they're in a very bad place. So I suppose that's my answer to that.
Oh yeah, fair enough. Just give me a second. I'm just responding to someone.
In another place.
Oh,
that's fine. In the meantime, I'll just someone said European Mohammedans get sucked into Western materialism. Yes, they do. I see that. You see them driving around in SUVs with rims, drinking alcohol, that's haram, smoking hashish, all very bad. I mean, the thing is, though, you'll find that they do this and then do something like join ISIS. You know, the man who was smoking hashish the other week and getting involved in gang activity, but the next week he's joining ISIS. How does that work? This is how it's always been throughout history. The majority of people in the Ottoman armies, I'm sure there were a bunch of degenerates in there, but they still have their nationalistic colors, which is effectively what Mohammedanism is for many of these individuals. What's your thought on that?
Oh, I totally agree. Now, like I said, who are these individuals actually side with, them or us, if it came down to it? They wouldn't side with us because they know themselves to be distinctly non-Western in spirit, in non-European, non-Anglo. That's why they're still Muslims. That's why they still call themselves Muslims, even though they're bad Muslims. At the end of the day, they would side with their brothers against anyone else, quite clearly. Hold on a minute. Let me see here. Man, the scroll function on this is a bit broken. MidCal9 says, do you mean we have to believe in God and or gods again? That's the surface level sort of exoteric religiosity. I believe in God. I pray to God. What a religion serves as, however, is an umbrella for a collective. I mean, what makes Muslims Muslims rather than, you know, Kurds, Syrians, etc.? What makes them or enables them to be perceived as a block from even our eyes? The fact that they have this one overarching structure, which does differ. There are nuances and subtleties between the Shias and Sunnis and so on. But the fact of the matter is, Europe collectively is in free fall. Our institutions are nihilistic and self-destructive. A European postmodern sort of man can morally rationalize his own suicide and the suicide of others and the killing of others. He can, through kind of postmodern ideologies, a la Marxism, post-Marxism, etc., justify the death of his own nation and the death of his families and all the families in his nation and the destruction of his culture and himself in all forms. And the fact of the matter is, it is only an overarching religious structure which is supra-rational, as in beyond that which is deductible through basic reason, and logic and rationality. Only a structure like that, which is somewhat impenetrable from that sort of perspective, only that can serve as an umbrella with which we can form communities again and form nations again, where we have a cohesive identity and we're allowed to, within this structure, have a cohesive identity with which to face off against this foreign force, which is going to arise in the next century or sooner. You have to look at religion and what it does and what it means on a, I suppose you might say, utilitarian level. What is the function of a religion in a society beyond just or beyond it being a repository for big T truth, which is what all religions are, right? But what is the function of a religion? What is the function of a community? And how can communities emerge? The fact of the matter is, we've lost that in the West. We now live in a world of hyper individualism and atomization, whereby the individual doesn't belong to a family, a race, a group, a culture, a nation. And individuals like this mean nothing in large-scale conflicts or larger dialectics which can happen over centuries regarding clashing cultures. And that's what we're seeing, the clash of cultures, essentially, the clash of civilizations, if you like. Perhaps right now in many areas we're still safe and materially abundant and these things aren't so much noticeable, but it is happening. It's happening when we know all the propaganda, we know all that's happened, we know we can spot political correctness, but all these things are indicative of something, and religion is the buffer against these things, and it will have to be as a survival mechanism, essentially. So yeah, that's that. One Man's Chorus asks, Adam, would Turks and Lebs side with Pakistanis and Somalis against Europeans? I don't know. I think they would. They're Muslim. They aren't Christian or atheists.
Yeah, I do as well. With Lebanese Christians, I believe that they would side with Europeans. And with minorities in Turkey, indeed, I believe they would side with Europeans. But by and large, the Mohammedan populations of those countries, I think, would side with the Mohammedan, the other respective countries. That's generally how it works.
Yeah, it's due to the nature of Islam. It's an all-consuming force, as has been discussed in or described in the chat. It acts as a wave, a hyper-collectivistic wave. As I said earlier, you have the House of Islam, which is peaceful and often takes form in a caliphate or something, and the House of War, which is where the infidels are, and there is perpetual struggle outwards from the House of Peace towards the House of War. This is the dualism which
well, hello. Anyway, whilst Adam's out, I think the dualism.
I was going to say.
Are you there? Good.
Yeah, I am there. This is the dualism with which Islam contextualizes itself historically through war and so on. And again, it's all observable. The history is all there. Oh boy. 1 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, sorry. Have I been keeping you up? I love you too, Lysander, by the way. Oh, I see all these Slavs in the stream. I'm glad we've got all these Slavs on our side. It makes me feel good. I used to be a Slavaboo, a Slavophile, whatever. I used to quite adore Slavs. I thought that they were no offense to the Slavs here, but there was a bit of a noble savage romanticization going on there for me, I suppose. I knew that Jews were a very sort of feminized race, if anything, just because of our diasporic status. And then already you have that, you had some Greek fellow writing that the Syrians, in other words, the Levantine peoples, were effeminate. So it's not a great situation. I always respected masculine peoples, in a sense. That's what I saw in extreme degree in Mohammedanism, but it's not only is Mohammedanism masculine,
I wouldn't say it's masculine. I'd say there's elements are there, but they aren't expressed very well. It's often very rabid and feral. Masculine cultures exist, such as medieval Christianity and the Knights Templar, for example. That's definitely masculine.
Oh, I would certainly agree with you, but is that spirit still to this day present in European Christianity? I would say
no, it's not really. And that's what we need to find. Midcal 9 asks, do you think such an overarching structure can be created again, referring to religiosity? Also, anything can be justified. What is cannot create a more ought or thou shalt? Well, to the first part, yes, it can be created again. And indeed it must. If Europe or European countries and so on are to survive in the coming century, they will have to regain their identity, and that will include religiosity, which is super rational and gives higher meaning and purpose to life and so on. And also anything can be justified. If you're a moral relativist or a nihilist, you can fuck off. Basically, I don't care about your opinions whatsoever. So go away. And I'm not saying that because I don't care about debating. It's just I've been there and I've done that and I don't care.
Yeah, it's old ground. I know precisely what you mean.
It is old ground and I have no reason to recover it. If you're a nihilist or a moral relativist, you cannot morally justify keeping yourself alive or keeping your family alive or vice versa. You might as well just kill everyone if you like. You know, why not? Just kill yourself.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, your only response to that is, oh, it might hurt.
Yeah, so why is killing someone bad? Because it causes pain.
But why is pain bad? You know?
Oh, good point, yeah.
You know, whatever. But I think I'm straw manning him there, but I don't think he actually is. And for Christian identity as well, I don't know. Like I said earlier, I think there would have to be a schism in the Catholic Church whereby the cucked and the uncucked are differentiated, basically.
There often does need to be sort of a temporary purging of the cucks. I think that sort of an inverse of what National Review did, let's say.
Okay. Yeah. Shiny Beast says, how can we keep our ethnic relativism and universalism out of our religiosity? That's interesting. Well, it'd have to be expressed differently. I'm quite sure French Christianity is not the same as German Christianity from the medieval perspective, for instance. Again, you'd have to look. You'd have to read about these things and see how they are. They will be anyway, because each nation. That's why we have different nations in Europe, because we're all differentiated. We have different histories, English Christianity or English myth, English culture involves Arthurian legend, for example, which is pagan, and yet, and so is the Holy Grail, actually, and yet the Holy Grail became a Christian symbol. Again, so it all depends on circumstance, and it happens naturally. Again, but it's all there historically. You can look it all up. Yeah, you have the resources available to you. Yes, basing this on utilitarian views seems weak. We need people to feel these ways for more genuine reasons, because it is objective truth that is all we need. I agree, yeah. I'm just approaching it from that base level, just to wet one's foot in the water, so to speak. To poke your toe in the bath just to get started. The idea that there is objective truth, which is metaphysical, is a very alien concept to most Europeans. At the present time, most young Europeans, it's just the way it is. But it can change. People can be educated. People can see things in a different manner. And I think they will do it in time.
Yeah. But I would say that at its core, the idea of having an objective perspective is distinctly European.
Yeah, absolutely. Someone says, Jim Smith says, aren't you an atheist, Adam? No. Well, no, I'm not an atheist. I'm not irreligious. I could be described as a perennialist or a metaphysician or a hermeticist in a very loose way. But I'm not irreligious.
So next time anyone needs a metaphysician, just give him a ring.
Just hit me up, you know? Perennialist seems to be the best word. Perennialist. I'm interested in perennial philosophy and in perennial religiosity and metaphysics. That is the fundamental truths behind all religions, which are expressed differently in different circumstances, which is what religion is. So there are fundamental truths at the core of all major religions, but these truths are expressed differently in different circumstances for different races, time periods, etc. And that's what religion is. I don't exist within a religious structure. So I've gone straight to the metaphysics, which lies behind and above it all. But that isn't something most people can do because they need that cultural kind of link, you know. And I suppose I do have the cultural link. I have a very pagan approach, similar to Jonathan Bowden and Julius Evola. But similarly, I'm a firm dualist, which is a very Christian sort of framework. I'm especially Catholic. So again, there are parallels between all these things. But regardless, I'm not irreligious, and I do not advocate for irreligiosity at all. But I enjoy being alive, and that is all. And yes, I'm a Nietzschean moral relativist. If you're a Nietzschean, you aren't a moral relativist. Nietzsche saw power as morality, the kind of pagan element of man. And Nietzsche tried to formulate something without God, without that system. Well, fundamentally, it wasn't enough. The Nietzschean style was already mastered by the ascetics of the ancient world. I mean...
Yeah, I was about to say there is an innate degree of it found in... Hello?
Hello, yeah. You're breaking up like crazy.
Hello?
Hello. Yeah, you're fine.
Yeah, sorry about that. No, just go ahead. About Nietzsche
Nietzsche was quick and clever to try and do what he did, and he was definitely on the money. But the fact of the matter is, the Nietzschean understanding is fundamentally esoteric. It isn't exoteric. Not everyone can become a Nietzschean or the Übermensch. And the fact is, it's nonsense to assume that can be the case for everyone. That you have to differentiate between the person and the collective. Or even the person and an individual. Let's not go into that. But from a personal perspective, if you understand Nietzsche and are interested in these things, then sure, that's an esoteric position. And if it works for you, it works for you. But it isn't going to be the case for most ordinary people. Most ordinary people need an exoteric religious structure to relate to, and that gives meaning to life. It gives a framework for life. People get married in a church. It puts them somewhere.
It gives them a place at a place, and therefore a perspective from which to look upon the world.
Exactly.
I think that's one of the biggest problems of people today is the lack of a knowledge of one's place in the universe.
Yeah. The point, you know, of any religion fundamentally is to give meaning to life beyond just material pursuits, because man is more than matter. Man creates art and poetry and beauty, not just for sex and to impress the opposite gender or sex, but because man is more than just the base and material need for survival. Man has higher capacities. And that's what religion is a part of. And that's why we still have religion in the world today. Like I said earlier, if religion as a fundamental idea, if spirituality had no value or function at any level whatsoever, it would have been discarded thousands of years ago. We would have evolved out of it, if you see what I mean. But we haven't. And the most irreligious countries in the world are the most morally relativistic and are subject to historical circumstance, which is very exclusive and specific. So Scandinavia, there haven't been any, I mean, how many wars has Norway fought recently which have required certain things such as a strong sense of community? And you'll find social trust in these areas is going down the shitter, basically. Sweden, for instance, there was a video I saw a while ago of it's a kind of rape experiment where they had a car in a street. And they played sounds which seemed like, or made it seem like, a woman was being raped inside the car. And 80% of the people who passed the car in Sweden, who they walked past, they ignored it. Because it wasn't their problem. And again, all these things, these social elements, cultural elements, ideological elements, how people are educated, what they interact with in the day-to-day. Again, forming a people, forming a culture is extraordinarily complex, and there are many variables to be considered. But one of the most important things which Europe has lost is a sense of community and belonging to something which is prior to the individual, something which relates you to something which is before and beyond you, and which gives meaning to life and which gives context to life, not just for yourself, but for the collective as a whole.
And that gives you a trajectory, not for yourself, but vicariously through your group, which is utterly and desperately needed amongst young Europeans and young people in general today, in this day and age.
Absolutely. Because, again, like I said, we're facing up against forces which are dangerous, and this is to be our defense, and it needs to be our defense, and it will be our defense, and it is a defense. Let me have a look. I've got some hours of a long little ramble.
It's fine. Are you? If you're done that point, someone asked me a question.
Yeah, yeah. Do you think beauty is God's divine rubber stamp on creation?
Sorry. No, you go ahead with that. Then I'll answer the question from Zeus.
Okay.
Yeah,
you go. Beauty. I don't know about beauty, really. You're better off asking Scruton or Plato. I believe beauty is essential, and I suppose if God. Depends how you define God. I don't define God in the ordinary sense of a being. I define God as being, not a being. So God is the principle of being. Beauty is that which is transcendental and beyond just the mortal. Beauty is that which is supramortal, supratemporal, etc. Again, Plato first and foremost, Scruton if you're interested in such things, I would recommend. I know those guys spoke about beauty to some degree. Ed, do you want to?
Yeah. I was just the three greats, Scruton, Plato, and Jawline, says morality official. But I just wanted to. Someone addressed a question to me, which wasn't. Well, someone asked something about me. I believe it was something like Awakening of Zeus. He said, or she said, what motivates Babylonians Hebrew? What motivates some Babylonians Hebrew sorry, hold on one second.
Oh boy.
Okay, hold on. No, I was all right. What motivates Babylonian Hebrew to associate with quote unquote pro-white sympathies? All right, so I will say that there is one that is subjective. There is one reason that is subjective. And that is intimately personal to me. And then there is one that is objective, not universalist, but I suppose is looking at it from a universal standpoint. So my first would be my family in Iraq was immense. It was assisted immensely by the British Empire, during their administrative period, and prior to their administrative period in the region, they often worked with ethnic sort of higher tier ethnic minorities in the Middle East and North Africa, and basically. A lot of these, and around the world in general, in Africa as well, they developed a good rapport with the Indians and some of the Arabs as well. So, and a lot of because of that, one portion of my family was able to transfer themselves and their assets and their legacy over to England in the early 1800s, later another in the. Before the 50s was able to do a similar thing on my other side. So, but that also that experience with them and because of that, I think to some degree, I've been partially anglicized, but I think my family culture has been to a large degree, I would say, but I think that this leads me to the objective thing, the objective reason, which is, as I have experienced Western culture, well, first of all, I noticed what Western culture was by noticing the anti-European thing that was going on. I noticed that, and that was first what alerted me to really looking into this whole business at a rather young age. But I think that really, Europeans are, I'll just leave it at this. Even if you take things like technological advancement out of it, I think that Europeans are very morally developed, and I think that this is something that really, really should be, at the very least, preserved upon this planet, and should be
not necessarily even held up by the rest of the world, but acknowledged by the rest of the world. I'm not an Ottomanist. I'm not anti-Western. I'm not bent on destroying the West. I'm not one of those lefty types either. I suppose that I am more of a repatriationist / partitionist nationalist. I believe that everyone should have their own space to sort of self-determine. I'm something of an indigenist, but at the same time, I understand that certain cultures can excel in certain areas, and Europeans, I think, certainly excel in the field of amongst many others, morality. And I think that that must be preserved upon this earth, and I think that it is at risk as things currently stand.
Okay, yeah, very fair enough. I'd like to just address
something. Sorry about the long rant.
That's fine. No, I can't say much. I can't complain, can I?
Mine was a bit less good than yours, though. I'm not that impassioned about that topic. That's more something that I get asked over and over and over again. So,
yeah. Eco Machine, you're saying nihilists have been historically very brutal. Yes, they have, but for a reason. It was context. Pol Pot was a nihilist, fundamentally, but he did what he did for the glory of mankind and for the glory of the class and for the glory of struggle. Good luck getting, you know, metrosexual European hipsters to think such things.
Man bun having.
I mean, seriously. They were nihilists, but nihilism doesn't mean a lot if it's without context. You know, do you have any sympathy towards non-traditional white nationalists? I don't know. There are very few depends what you mean by traditional. You'd have to elaborate. What is non-traditional? What is traditional? Exactly. Minjiga Shup, a silly name. Nihilism will hold the gates open and laugh as the whores pour in, as you say. Absolutely. Non-Uber Catholics and such like. So I'm not an Uber Catholic. And you don't have to be to be a white nationalist, even though I said earlier, white means nothing to me. Exactly what is traditional, that'll be discussed in an upcoming series. Just to briefly outline it here without going into too much detail, small t traditionalism is just inherited culture, is inheritance. Big T traditionalism is metaphysical dualism and its implications. I won't go into that though. Jim Smith says most of these people can be saved. Yeah, they can. Most Europeans, I think, if you get down to it, will think, you know, it depends where you are in the world. Most of these sorts of French people, for example, will wake up eventually, or they'll be removed, or they'll be destroyed, won't they? Kvelt says, a reminder that not going to bed before midnight is degenerate. Yeah.
I would say indeed it is, yes.
Yeah, I mean, it's 1:30 in the morning. I should be
not going to bed before 6.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm so degenerate. I will go to bed, though, within the next 30 minutes.
You're indulging, Adam.
Yeah. Anything that is good and old and was approved by Evola. You don't understand Evola. Again, traditionalism, small t traditionalism, and big t traditionalism are not the same thing. And again, fucking hell, the divide between esoteric and exoteric, the divide between principles and their manifestations. I can't really explain this in much detail. I'm too fucking tired, to be honest. Yeah, I mean, even then, Evola wouldn't support real Catholics. He himself wasn't a proper Catholic.
Did he practice an indigenous religion?
No, he was like me, actually, perennialist. He described himself as a Catholic pagan, but he was fundamentally a perennialist. Grenon actually was a Muslim. He was a Sufist. Shuon was initiated in various things, including Sufism, actually, and Hinduism. and Christianity, I believe. I think it was the Eastern Orthodoxy, as far as I know.
I think it makes sense for Europeans to dabble in Hinduism.
I've always been very interested in sort of... Sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, the other traditionalists is all manner of things, but again, you need to differentiate between traditionalism or traditions as cultural phenomena and big T traditionalism, as in what the traditionalist school advocated and spoke about. Just go into Wikipedia and type traditionalist school, and that'll, you know, that's a neat little summary of things, essentially, for what that is. And there's a reason why that's a big T tradition. But dualism is false. No, it's not.
Tell that to a Semite.
Yeah, tell that to a Semite, tell that to the perennialist, tell that to the traditionalist, tell that to Evola, tell it to Grenon, tell it to Kumarasamy, tell it to Shuon, etc. You know, again, these things are the way they are. You can look them up and learn, or you cannot. It's just down to you. Talking about fucking sleep, how long you should sleep for.
Anything more than 6 hours is fucking degenerate.
Okay, sorry, Mid-Cali, that was a joke, okay.
No, Mid-Call. I was responding, it was probably my response. I was responding jokingly when I said that, and I didn't mean to draw him into
he said to me, because I responded to him saying dualism is false, but he was just kidding. It's just a joke. Fucking another joke, this went over my head. Oh my. It's 1:30 in the morning, I'm allowed to be a bit dense right now.
We're being given media recommendations. People to give. We're being asked to give media recommendations. I'll give one right now.
Yeah,
they give you a rather nice framework, and this one I rather like because it's not just accessible for Europeans. As a Semite, I rather enjoyed it. This was Spengler's Decline of the West. It's a tome, and it's divvied up into sections, but. If you read the portion, and I believe it's actually only a few pages out of this massive, massive book, but when they in the portion upon Semitic dualism, I think that there's a lot to be gained from that in understanding of both Abrahamic religion and Arabs and Jews and other Semitic and even more broadly Afro-Asiatic peoples. That's it, I suppose. I mean, what do you have any media recommendations, Mr. Wallace?
Oh, man, there are a few. It depends on what you want to be interested in or what you want to learn about, what you are interested in. Let me just list off a few books. The Gibalion, Evola's main works, so that's Revolting Against the Modern World, Man with the Ruins, and Ride the Tiger, as well as Evola's The Hermetic Tradition, as well as his Doctrine of the Awakening. As well as The Mystery of the Grail from Gainon, I'd say Introduction to the Study of the Hindu Doctrines, and of course The Crisis of the Modern World. From Spengler, like you, I would say The Decline of the West is definitely one to go through and pick things out of. Get the abridged version if you want, because it's not 1,000 fucking pages. It's terrifying.
Yeah.
I definitely recommend religious texts like The Kybalion, although that's not really on the same level as something like, and I would also suggest the Bible. I have a King James Bible, whatever you like, really. I would recommend people get a copy of the Quran and the Torah, maybe the Vedas, or some, you know, extend your religious understanding of the world.
I would additionally say what one should aim to broaden their ethnic understanding of the world. There's this amazing book that I was I'm not saying you're not, but there's this amazing book I was reading called The Horse, the Wheel, and Language. I just cracked it open about a week ago. It's about Indo-European migration. I think that stuff is fascinating, and I think that if I were a European, a white, an Indo-European, I would find it even more interesting to hear about, because I love things that connect me to the even broader network of people like Afro-Asiatics or things like that, so, you know, pan-Semitism, etc. I think it's interesting. Okay. So,
yeah. Don't read the Talmud, though. Fair enough. Other books. Imperial Aspiration says, don't read the Talmud, though. Diasporic religions are fucking demonic. No, you should understand.
Anything diasporic is bad.
Yeah, diasporic, yeah. But you should still understand it. You'd understand you should understand the bad in the world as you should understand the bad in yourself. You cannot gain a complete understanding of the world by only looking at one side of it. You have to look at the bad things as well. And on that note, I would recommend people look at Marcuse, Adorno, and Sartre, who are all Marxists, Maoists, and so on. Just so you can understand their sort of
Boas
thinking.
As well. Yeah, if you're interested in anthropology and race. Yep.
Gauls, etc. Bowden, I would recommend. Oh man, Western Civilization Bites Back. Mad. Oh crikey, there are a few. Trouble with balanced books is they're also obscure. Axe, I would recommend. I would recommend Marcus Willinger's Generation Identity. Oh man, I'm just trying to think of others now. As for things like essays, like I said earlier, John Glubb's The Fate of Empires.
Oh yes,
yeah,
that is a must-read. I think you should emphasize that, especially.
Yeah, that's definitely a very, very, very interesting read. That was the first serious read I actually ever read. That essay, the introductory essay to Men Amid the Ruins. By Dr. H.D. Hansen about Julius Evola's political endeavors is quite interesting. Oh man, there is so much, it's just a blur. As for books and reading, that's enough for me. I don't watch any films or listen to any mainstream radio or entertainment or whatever, so that'd be terrible. So I won't comment on those sorts of things. Are you familiar with David Irving? Yeah, sensationalist, I think. Attention seeker. Don't like him. Would it be possible to replace religion with racial consciousness? No, that's a fucking pathetic idea. What a stupid thing to say. Perhaps that was too harsh a reaction, but that's right.
Are you now going to temper that a bit?
No, I wouldn't bother tempering that because I think it's such a silly idea. It deserves scorn and hatred.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Fair enough. Well, I just want to add some reads that I recommend for people who are interested in West Asia. See, a lot of what I read is very pertinent to regional stuff and specific ethno-specific stuff, but so I'm not sure if people would be interested, but I think that people should read the author Bat Yeor. She wrote a book called Dimitude. I believe she coined that term, Dimitude, in that. But effectively, what she talks about is the conditions of life and the sort of spiritual subjugation that is faced by those living under Mohammedanism. And I mean, yes, you all sort of get it generally from hearing about it, but I think that's, I mean, this stuff is it's very interesting to know the specifics of it and the details of it, and especially from someone who's intimately familiar with it. She herself is from a Egyptian Jewish background, and she was the first in countless generations, in thousands of years, to have been displaced, rather like many people in my family. She also went to England, and where she wrote about the potential threat that Europe would end up facing. She coined the term Eurabia, Eurabia, as well. So yeah, I highly recommend you check her out and start with Dimitude.
Yeah, that's definitely interesting. I just linked a collection of PDFs that I used to sift through a few months ago. I haven't really touched this for quite some time. But there's plenty of interesting stuff there. There's some Evola, there's some Tarot stuff, there's a Kabbalion's there, the Iliad is there. There are some good things here. The theological and philosophical works of Hermes Trismegistus. Holy hell, that's a good one. The Odyssey is there. The Hermetic tradition from Ebel is there. The fate of empires is there. The decline of the West is there. Gustave Le Bon's The Crowd is there. A lot of this stuff, actually, I was linked to by Nobody TM. He specifically linked me to here Architecture, Mysticism, and Myth from Psyop to Mind War, Meditations of the Tarot on the Tarot. Hermeneutic Interpretation of Man and the Destiny of the Adamic Race. I want to transcribe that actually at some point because it's on a PDF. Sex and Character, that's Weininger, Otto Weininger, quite influential to Evola. Sex Symbolism in Religion, that's an important one. Again, it's all symbology and so on and so forth. I didn't ask if he was omniscient, my dear know-it-all. Okay. You didn't ask that, no, but you seem to have suggested it. Because in my mind, Evola is more learned and more intelligent than Spencer. So, you know.
Richard Spencer.
Yes. I like Spencer. I admire the man. And he's a very good man.
Well, but Spencer's a lot younger than Evola was when he came to a lot of his conclusions as well, one must realize.
Also, he's an American. So his perspective will not be complete due to the fact that he's American, in my view. I mean, the term white means nothing to Europeans. And
it's not a stable framework. Again, it's building upon something utilitarian reach something beyond utilitarianism, something spiritual, something meaningful. And I'm not sure if that can be done. I mean, time will tell right now. But
Thylacine says, you don't listen to mainstream music. I do listen to some mainstream music, but not ordinary things. Some bands I like, Tool, Meshuggah, King Crimson, Baroness, Burzum, just to name a few. I like a lot of Nobody TM's music. And Nietzsche was smarter than Evola. Not at all. Evola was smarter than Nietzsche. In fact, Evola actually criticizes Nietzsche in Ride the Tiger and explains exactly where Nietzsche went wrong and the way to overcome the problem that is inherent in the Übermensch. So
he rides the tiger all over his face.
Yeah, basically, yeah. But the fact is, Nietzsche was excellent. Nietzsche was a good man, and his philosophy is immensely important. And there are a lot of truths to his prognosis. However, it was incomplete. He died before all his work, or he went mad and died before all his work was really finished, and he really went full circle. Which is, how can you say it means nothing to Europeans? Because we've been killing each other for 4,000 years. And the term, you know, whiteness, it can serve something in the future if there is some sort of happening level race war from between Europe and the Middle East. But that's fucking you. That's hypothetical as hell.
Do you mind if I just quickly jump in and say something? America is a broken land in a way that Europe cannot rival. I would agree with that, but I would like to hear what your prognosis is, because I think that partition or Brazilification seem to be the two possible paths looking forwards.
Absolutely. And as Signa says, a pan-European alliance could work temporarily, but not as a permanent thing. Absolutely. Yes, regarding America, you probably know, you'd be better off speaking about America than I would be. But pan-Europeanism is... You could have alliances between countries and states, but the idea that the entirety of Europe would band together is pure nonsense.
Right, the Battle of Vienna, to some degree. I believe we even referenced that earlier in this call. I would say that Christendom has been pan-Europeanism to some degree.
And that's Christendom, and that's a religion. And that's a religion, and only something like that could do something like that. Only a religion could bring about an event like that. And it only happened once, didn't it? Only happened once. The fact of the matter is, we have been warring internally for thousands of years. In a moment of crisis, we'd band together and form alliances. But Europe does not act as one single block in the way that America would, for instance. Even then, America has its share of internal conflicts. Again, pan-Europeanism is an American, or at least an American-based idea, in my opinion. And it can, as Thylacine says, only work through Christianity. And it would
only through that framework would pan-Europeanism come about in a moment of crisis, and I think it would. I don't think it's nonsense to assume that that couldn't happen under that circumstance, but this idea that all Europeans just have some sort of overall pan-racial awareness, which is all the same in all the same frequencies, is pure utopian hypothetical.
Well, interestingly enough, as a counterpart to that, the Ottoman Empire simultaneously acted as a form of inadvertent pan-Semitism in its existence. I think that such things like that really are only... It can come from religion, or it can come from wartime alliances to some degree, really. But without an enemy to define yourself against, even with religion, if it was just a bunch of Christian European states, I doubt that that would remain peaceful for long, you know what I mean?
I totally agree with you, yeah. And I think Islam can be that. Islam can be that force which pushes Europe to kind of possibly behave like this in the future.
Cygnus has a good question.
Let me see here. Christianity divided so many sects already. That's a good point. And like I said earlier, Christianity in Europe would have to undergo change in the future. And I think it will. A moment of crisis can do interesting things. If Europe will learn how to act as one block, then it is toast. And yes, Europeans also learn that we do have a lot in common. No, I disagree. Europe doesn't need to act as one block. Germany, unified, could solve all these problems instantly, really, if Germany decided to. It has the technology and the power and the resources, but it won't. What we need to see before any of this, before any sort of alliances and so on, is the idea of... And this has been discussed elsewhere, and I've raised this point many times, that the morality has to be inverted, that we have power needs to become a good thing again. We need to see self-assertion and the idea that we can put ourselves and our people and our community first before others, and to be exclusive, that has to be seen as a good thing.
As opposed to the championing of weakness and self-flagellation, absolutely, which we see now.
Exactly. That's the first step. Midcal 9 asks, as for religion, how would you bring it back? I don't know, and I would guess that a schism in the church would have to take place, and existential threat would help, really. It's about the rebuilding of community within the moral framework I just described. Again,
do you mind if
I'm far too tired to start answering these questions seriously. It's 22 in the morning, and
Before you go to sleep, I've got one last question for you. I would say that even if pan-Europeanism isn't possible, I would say that in the soul, this is something I was going to go into before. I was going to say something about Indo-Europeanism, but or Aryanism or whatever, but with that's with a Y. But I think that there is something, at least at the very least, in the soul. Soul. Yeah, where can you point to that in the body? There is something in the Western Indo-Europeans that is a likeness, something that they have in common with one another that makes them different, for instance, from the Afro-Asiatics or, I don't know, the East Asians, of course, is a rather long example, but I would say Afro-Asiatics and even some Caucasian peoples, for example. I say that there's something very distinct about the Western Indo-Europeans. Despite the variance between them.
I'd agree. I think on that note, I'm actually going to fucking go to bed because I'm really tired.
All right. Well, it's been a pleasure talking to you. Thank you.
Yeah, man, it's been really nice.
We should certainly do this again sometime. I mean, I don't know. What does the chat think? Has this been a good experience?
I think it has.
I would be inclined to agree, yeah.
Yeah, so thank you for joining me, and I'm going to go to bed. So take it easy.
Take care. Have a nice one.
See you.